Isaiah chapter 60. Now tonight is going to be very prophetic. Did you hear me?
Yes.
Tonight's going to be very prophetic, and I'll tell you why I know that. I don't have a clue what I'm supposed to talk about. And I know any time that happens to me, when I come in, you feel like an empty vessel is the only way I know how to say it. It's like there's no preconceived notions or, you know, it doesn't always work that way. Last Sunday, the Lord gave me a message in the early morning hours and told me to preach it, but He hasn't given me anything. And just by experience, I know that when that happens, that He's wanting to talk through me. Now, He always wants to talk through us, but there's times where He just wants us more out of the way than we are normally.
Right.
Amen? So get yourself out of the way right now tonight.
Yes.
If you're wanting to be home at a certain time to watch your favorite TV program, forget it.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to probably minister very long, as far as I know anyway. But not as long as Mike did this morning anyway. But just become that. Become that one that He can pour something into.
Amen.
Isaiah 60 is, of course, if you've been around here for a while, you know these scriptures are very dear to my heart because of years ago, in a time when I was really wondering if I was pastoring the church right, wondering if we were doing things right, so forth and so on. Because the devil will tell you every day of your life, if you listen to him, that you're not. Does he tell you you're not doing something right every day?
Yeah.
These scriptures, the Lord spoke to me and He said, because it was concerning this church and concerning the vision that He had given me when we first started the church in 1983, He showed me this church would eventually be a large fellowship, numerically speaking, and that it would be like a large hospital in this area, a large spiritual hospital. Just like a large medical center where they have emergency personnel that keep people from dying, and upstairs long-term people that help you get well and get back into your life and society and be a productive citizen. That's what He said this church would be. He showed me that early on.
Amen.
And of course, that was over 30 years ago now. And, you know, we have these ideas when we're younger. You know, I'm sure Joseph thought that his dream about being a big shot and in charge and a man of prominence would happen in about, you know, a year or two.
Yeah.
And we think these things, but when you study the Bible, it's on God's timing.
Yep.
Yeah.
Amen. He's talking about a lifetime of Him working in your life. Well, anyway, that day when I was having that little struggle there, and I asked the Lord, and I wasn't asking Him why He wasn't doing things. I was asking Him if I was doing things right.
Amen.
Another thing I learned a long time ago is that the problem is never God.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Amen.
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 So we need to check up on ourselves. Amen. I remember Brother Hagin, Kenneth Hagin, which is a man that God used to mentor me through his tapes and books and his services. He said when he was pastoring, he said he was he saw he wasn't having as much results. You know, what he saw in the Bible wasn't happening like it should be in his congregation. So he's praying and fasting, seeking God. And he's asking the Lord to do more and this and that. And he said that the Lord led him to a certain scripture, showed him what he would do if the gospel was preached. He said, I know, Lord, I know that scripture. He said, that's what I'm trying to get you to do. I'm trying to get you to do what it says in the scripture. And he said, the Lord said, read it again. So he read it about 10 times, and finally it dawned on him what the Lord was saying. The Lord said, check up on what you're preaching. I said, I would perform my word with signs and wonders following. Are you preaching my word, or are you preaching about what you think about my word? And he said, I started checking up on myself, and he said, I found about almost half of what I was preaching was tradition. It wasn't the word at all. Bible, Jesus said the traditions of men make the word of God of no power.
Yeah.
Come on, are you here?
Yeah.
And so he had to make some adjustments, and when he started preaching the word, God began to confirm his word with signs following.
Amen.
Yeah.
Exciting, isn't
it?
Isaiah 60. He led me to these scriptures when I here, back in those days when I was wondering about that. Well, let me just say it this way. Here's what he said to me first. He said, when Isaiah 60, verses 1 and 2 are happening in the earth, that's when you'll see the church come to the fullness.
Thank you, Jesus.
Grow into the fullness of what I've told you. And it's not just numeric, it's not just about having bodies in a building, a big church. It's about a hospital. It doesn't do any good to have a whole staff in a hospital or even patients in a hospital if nobody knows what they're doing. I don't know about you, but I don't want the person that knows how to run the local bingo game operating on my heart. Amen? So it has to do with preparing the personnel. It has to do with God gathering the people together and growing them up spiritually and imparting into them and preparing them to play their part. Amen?
Amen.
This is not a me thing as pastor. This is a we thing.
Amen.
So he told me that when these scriptures were manifesting in the earth is when the church would be in the fullness of what he told me it would be when we first started the church. I had no idea what he said. He told me Isaiah 61:2. I had no idea what it said. But let's read it. Arise, shine, for your light. Say my light.
My light.
Is come. Now notice, is come. He's pointing to a point in time. Arise and shine, for your light's come. Now I know we have the light of God in us. We are the light of the world and all that. I understand that. But if you read on in this, you'll see he's talking about a time where a greater glory shines. Amen? A greater glory shines. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. For behold, now he's telling us, here's how the world's going to go. Darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness to people. That word, those words, gross darkness, you look them up in the Hebrew, they mean darkness that can be felt. He's talking about demonic spirits, demonic presence, hell assaulting the earth and the people in the earth, and people feeling the oppression and darkness and confusion and all the things that comes with that. I'll tell you what, we've got some pretty confused folks in the United States today. Amen? For behold, darkness will cover the earth and gross darkness to people, but the Lord shall rise upon thee. Notice he says, at a point in time, when gross darkness, when demons seem like they're everywhere, people are running around confused. Crazy things are happening. Amen. In the earth. Yeah. Crazy demonic things. Amen?
Yep.
He says that at that time, the Lord shall arise upon you. Now back up in verse 1, he says, arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord's risen upon you. Notice how many times they use the word arise and risen here. But the Lord shall arise upon thee, and his glory shall be seen upon thee.
Amen.
So he was pointing to a point in time, and even in saying that to me that night, he said, in the day when these verses are coming to pass, is when the church will be what I told you would be. It's actually the glory harvest. You see, Jesus was a seed.
Amen.
He was a seed the Father planted in the earth.
Yes.
At the end of his life, when he was about to go be crucified, the Greeks came and said, we want to see this guy. The Greeks were into body worship. They were the people that started all the gyms.
Yeah. Come on, buddy.
They were the ones that started the Olympics. They used to get out and run naked in races and wrestle. And when they first started all that, you wrestled until you or your opponent was dead. I mean, these guys were serious about the physical aspect of things. And they came to Jesus' disciples and said, we want to see, you know, we've heard about all these miracles and signs and wonders. This guy must be, you know, he must be quite a specimen. And so I think it was Philip, if I remember correctly, the disciple they talked to, he came to Jesus and he said, they want to see you. And Jesus' answer sounded so weird. He said something along this line. I wouldn't read it to you, but I'd have to look it up. I don't know where it's at in the Gospels. He said, if you cast a seed into the ground and it dies, then it'll bring forth much fruit. He was referring to his body and referring to himself as a seed. He was a seed the Father put in here. What kind of seed was he? You know, every seed produces after its kind. He was a glory seed. Now, when I say glory, I'm talking about all that God is and all that he has. Amen? I'm not talking about credit. You get the glory or you get the credit. You know, matter of fact, How many of you have heard people, and I've said it myself for years,
Amen.
God won't share his glory with anybody. Well, what that means is God won't share the credit with anybody.
Yeah.
You give credit where credit is due. Render unto God the things that are God, and to Caesar the things that are Caesar's. Amen?
Right. Amen?
But he wants you to share in his manifested kingdom glory.
Amen.
He's turning us into the glorious church.
Amen.
If he won't share his glory with anybody,
yeah.
then he's working against himself. That just doesn't make sense.
Amen?
Amen.
So, Jesus saw himself as a seed. And of course, if you know about seeds, when you plant a seed, the first thing that happens to the seed is what?
It dies.
It dies. And then there's kind of a resurrection type thing that happens there, where a little root starts to sprout out. And then once that's established, then it begins to come up out of the earth into a plant and begins to grow and eventually becomes that tree or that plant where fruit is born, more seeds are reproduced, and so forth. Well, Jesus died. He said in his last days over there in John, he said, Father, I have glorified you.
Yeah.
And he said this, he said, the glory which you have given me, I've given to them.
Amen.
Yeah.
I've given to them.
Yes.
They didn't look like too glorious of a bunch at that point.
Come on.
They were arguing with him about whether he was supposed to go to the cross or not. When it all came down and they saw Jesus yielding to the Roman Empire, and even when they'd seen, for 3.5 years, the devil never been able to corner him. Tried to throw him off a cliff, wasn't able to. All these different things. But here Jesus yielded. So they didn't understand that because they were trying to understand spiritual things with natural comprehension. And if you do that, you're going to miss it every time.
Yes.
That's why Jesus told Peter when Peter had the revelation that this is not just another prophet anointed by the Spirit like we've heard of in times past. You are the King Messiah, the Son of the living God.
Amen.
Yeah.
And Jesus says, Peter, you are acting in the characteristics of God. In other words, flesh and blood's not telling you their opinion, who do men say that I am, and so forth. But you have heard by revelatory comprehension from the Holy Ghost, and he showed you by revelation who I am. And because of that, you're not going to be some wishy-washy, built-on-sand person. You're going to be a rock. And if you walk in that revelation and let that revelation, see, that was just the beginning of Peter's understanding of Jesus and the kingdom. If you walk with me, I'm going to build on that, expound on that, and take you into a place where your life is solid.
Yes.
Now, if you study Peter, you find that eventually he became a person who had the overshadowing of God on his life and a luminous cloud of glory around him. And at times when that would manifest, if you got inside that glory cloud, anything that wasn't of God left you.
Yeah.
And whatever was of God came to you.
Amen.
He became, in my opinion, as I've studied that, a prototype of the glorious church.
Wow.
Yeah. I mean, isn't that what it says right here? It says, his glory shall be seen upon you.
Yeah.
Come on, are you here?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've seen the light of God on people at times. Not too many times. I remember one time we were in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Brother Hagin was up on the stage up there, in that big building, thousands of people. And they were putting it on TV or recording it or something. And so he's up there and they got this big old bright TV light, just blasting down on him. And I'm looking at him and all of a sudden his face was shining brighter than anything else on the stage. And I'm thinking, oh, that must be the reflection of those TV lights or something. And then shortly after that, he walked down off the stage and walked over into a dark corner, but his face was still shining like a light bulb. I went, oh my God, that's the glory of the Lord.
Yes.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Amen. The Bible says that as we look into the face of Jesus, we're changed into that same image from one level and stage of glory to another.
Amen.
His glory shall be seen upon you. There's been stories told and incidents happened where people have actually seen that. Matter of fact, Royce, that happened to you one time when you were delivering the mail. Somebody saw the glory on you, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah. Praise God. So the point I'm making here is this, is that we should be yielding to and walking toward progressively a more glorious place in Him.
Yes.
a more glorious place in Him. Now, how do we get there? You know, the rest of this chapter is about all the good things and wonderful things and powerful things that are going to happen. Turn with me over to, let's turn over to the book of Matthew, chapter 16. Now, you may have heard this before, but let me tell you something. This is not just going to fall on us like ripe apples off of a tree.
Amen.
We're going to have to recognize the season we're in.
Amen.
The story Karen told about the financial blessing. We've been, for the last couple of months, the Lord has made us aware prophetically in our prayer services and different things. He's made us aware that it's a season for us to begin to prosper.
Yes.
It's a season where we were in a jubilee year. Actually, today is Rosh Hashanah, which is the Jewish New Year, the civil new year for the Jewish nation. It's where they blow the trumpets. If you were at a synagogue tonight, you would hear 100 trumpet blasts.
Wow.
And what that is, it's a wake-up call, because in 10 days is going to be the Day of Atonement, which is where the high priest in the old covenant would go in and he would sprinkle the blood on the mercy seat, and God would judge the nation based on their heart and their prepared heart before Him. That's why they're blowing the trumpet now. You got 10 days to get anything out of your life that doesn't need to be there. This will be 10 days of introspection, searching your heart. God, is there any wicked way in me? Any perverse way in me? Did I tell somebody I pay him some money and haven't paid him back?
Come on.
Amen. So, let's hope. Or whatever. Am I holding on to you? Whatever it is.
Yeah. Come on,
brother. Amen. And so today is that day. Matter of fact, I was born 1951. I was born the second day of Rosh Hashanah. My mom recounted the whole experience to me today when I was over here. She didn't know I'd heard about 50 times before. And I apologized again that she had to go through that. But I'm just having fun. But let me just say this, and I want you to catch the spirit of what I'm saying. Anything I say tonight is not to boast on me or put me in the limelight or any of that kind of thing.
Amen.
These are things that the Lord has, I believe, revealed to me. Amen. He talked to me about my 65th birthday, mm-hmm. and He said that from that day forward, things would be different, not only in my life, but in the earth.
Amen.
And it wasn't because it was my birthday.
Amen.
It was because of the prophetic day. See, the different Jewish holidays, we don't necessarily have to keep those days, now in the yearly cycle, because many of them have already been fulfilled in Christ.
Right.
We walk in it spiritually speaking.
Yes.
Amen?
Yeah.
And so, you know, just like the Passover, we had the Body and Blood today. Amen. Passover holiday for the Jews is in the spring, but we can celebrate. You can go home and have communion every day at your own house if you want to.
Yeah.
And just celebrate Jesus and who He is, because He's perpetually there as your high priest. The blood is there. All that is done to set you free is available. There's no doubt about that.
Amen.
But there are, and I believe this is true after studying and so forth, that these holidays on the Jewish calendar, these holy days, are a prophetic marker.
Yes.
They're a prophetic marker for something to shift or change in the earth. And I don't have time to go into all the reasons I believe that. But today, like I said, up to today, the Lord was showing me that there was going to be a shifting take place on this day today.
Amen. Yeah.
And it's not that there wasn't anything happening up to that day and all of a sudden something's going to happen. No, it was like the things that have been happening in a smaller scale are now going to begin to accelerate and go up and come into a higher place and a greater scale.
Amen.
God is the God of increase.
Yes.
He's the God of increase. Look here in Matthew 16. Verse 1, the Pharisees also with the Sadducees. Now, who were these folks? They were the blind, spiritually blind religious leaders in Jerusalem.
Yeah.
They were religious men. They wore all the religious garb. They had their religious system. And if you study it, you find out that it started good with Moses, of course, but it kind of morphed into this political religious system based on position, power, and money, honey. Just like it always, always seems to do with people that end up trying to, climb the ladder, so to speak. So the Pharisees and Sadducees came tempting and desiring him that he would show them a sign from heaven. You see, Jesus was a threat to them.
Yes, he was.
Because of what he did and things he said. They weren't so much afraid that he was going to work a miracle. They were afraid that Rome was going to get mad because the people were getting stirred up about this. And it was their job to keep the people kind of settled down in their routine of worship, their yearly cycle routine of worship, so that they could please Rome and they could stay in their power position and they could continue to enrich themselves. So they were afraid. Even in one place in Scripture, in the Gospels, you'll see where they were upset. One guy said, they're going to remove us from our position. Rome's going to remove us from our position if we let this keep going on. So they came to him trying to, corner him, trying to trip him up, and asked him to show him a sign from heaven. He answered and said unto them, when it is evening, you say it will be fair weather, and the sky is red, for the sky is red. And in the morning, it will be foul weather today, for the sky is red and lowering. O you hypocrites, you can discern the face of the sky, but can you not discern the signs of the times? Now this word times here, actually this phrase here, is the word kairos in the Greek, and kairos means a spiritual season. It's that which time gives you opportunity to do. It's the will of God for your life. It's what God is doing right now.
Yeah.
See, we can be like the Pharisees and the Sadducees. God can be in a season wanting to do something in our life and even doing it with people around us. But if we don't know that that's the case, we're not only not going to partake of it, we will probably fight against it.
True.
Amen. Preach it.
The greatest enemy of a new, fresh breath move of God is the old move of God.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Amen.
Hallelujah. Well, the Bible says there's nothing new under the sun. You're absolutely right, but there is something fresh under the sun.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. If people get carnal and people get into a place where, the wind of the Spirit isn't blowing anymore in their services or in their denomination or in their life or their family, that when the wind comes along, it's not new, but it sure is refreshing.
Amen.
So get in.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. If the rains of heaven start falling, get out in it.
Yeah.
Don't put up the umbrella of unbelief and doubt.
Yeah.
Well, how do I know it's from God? My pastor doesn't teach this. Or, my grandma said this is not God. How do I know if it's God? The Bible says that Jesus said that's very simple. He said if a tree is bearing good fruit, it's a good tree.
Yeah.
You may not like the bark. You may think it's the ugliest tree you've ever seen in your life. It may not have the kind of leaves you think it ought to have. Or even look like it's supposed to, or maybe even growing. It's not supposed to even grow here in this climate.
Yeah.
But if it's bearing good fruit, it's a good tree.
Yes. Amen.
Yes.
Jesus bore good fruit.
Yes. Amen.
Everywhere he went, he delivered people from the works of darkness.
Amen.
He blessed people.
Amen.
He helped people. He helped them get healed and blessed. And so you don't judge a book by the cover.
Right.
Amen. You look and see what kind of fruit's being produced.
Yes.
Amen.
And you look and see what kind of fruit's not being produced.
Right.
If it's not being produced in your life, stop and say, God, I think you need to fertilize this tree a little bit here.
Yes. Amen.
I think you need to put some water on this tree. Lord, help me to be the tree. The Bible says that we're the planting of the Lord.
Yes.
And that if we are planted in the house of our God, we'll flourish
right.
in the courts of our God.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Lord.
So he says you can't discern the spiritual season you're in, the Kairos season, the signs of the times. Think about it. Here's God in the flesh standing in front of them, a tremendous, powerful move of God operating through him. And these guys are supposed to be the religious, spiritual leaders of the nation. They're looking right at it and don't even know who he is. Matter of fact, they're plotting to kill him.
Yeah.
That just shows you how stupid we really are.
Yes.
Without God.
Yes.
We're as ignorant as the day is long without God.
Amen.
I heard Norval Hayes years ago, he said, you and I will never know how stupid we really are until we get to heaven. He's probably right. Now notice verse 4. He gives them a little more info here. I don't think they got it, but he gave it to them anyway. A wicked and adulterous generation seeks after a sign. Wicked. What does wicked mean? It means twisted. Wicker furniture, twist that, the way they twist it. Wicked. See, the devil comes and he twists things in your life. He tries to twist even the scriptures. He came to Jesus and tried to twist the scripture to get him to jump off of the temple and commit suicide, basically. Amen? A wicked, a perverse generation, things that are twisted. Don't let the devil twist the things of God.
Amen.
Go to God. Get with him. Seek him with all your heart.
Yes.
Say to the Holy Spirit, because the Bible says it, you're the teacher of the church. I want you to teach me. And then God's going to put people in your life that you can bounce things off of, too.
Yes. Amen.
Amen. Amen. That's one of the reasons you want to go to a local church, because there'll be people in that church that have more experience than you have, and they can help you grow in Christ.
Yes. Yes.
But anything anybody says, whether it's me or anybody else, it's got to be based in Scripture, and it's got to harmonize with the whole counsel of God, not pick and choose a little buffet Scripture thing and make it say whatever you want it to say.
Amen.
Right. There's a Scripture that says, Judas went and hanged himself. There's another Scripture that says, go down and do likewise. So you could have a doctrine of suicide.
Yeah.
If you're going to do that buffet, pick the Scriptures out that way.
Right.
Amen?
Right.
You see, the Bible harmonizes with itself. That's one reason I like to let it define its own terms. I like to look up things, words, in different contexts, because it gives you that whole picture of what's really being said. Anyway, that's a whole other different story. But a wicked and adulterous generation. An adulterer is someone who breaks covenant. Fornication is when people have sexual relations before or outside of marriage. Adultery is when someone's married and they go have relations with someone else. What was happening here is these men, instead of being true to the covenant of God and the Word of God, and submitting themselves to God in what he shows them in the Old, in the Old Testament, the Mosaic Law, they were over here bowing their knee to Rome, and they were trying to play both things at the same time.
Yes.
And that's not going to work.
Amen.
You can't mix oil and water and get a drink.
Amen.
You can't let darkness come, deception come flooding in and walk in light.
Right. Amen.
Sometimes I've had the Lord sometimes get on me about things, and I'm thinking, well, what's the big deal about that? But he knows.
Yeah.
He knows what the devil's trying to set you up with.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. If he tells you stay away from that, or stay away from that person, or go over here and connect with these people in this church or whatever, he knows exactly what he's talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
These people were committing spiritual adultery as a result. They were covenant breakers. As a result, the devil had a legal right to come in and set up his demonic kingdom system right in the temple in Jerusalem.
Yep.
Yeah.
When Jesus went in there and turned over those money tables, he wasn't just, I'm ticked off, I've had it, I'm going to go blow up on these dudes.
Mm-hmm.
That wasn't what it was about. It was about that system. Where he told them what it was about. He said, this is supposed to be a house of prayer, and you've made it a den of thieves.
Yes.
Yes.
And then he went and he cursed the fig tree. After that, the fig tree is a prophetic symbol of Israel. The sweet figs, the God's fig tree, his sweet nation, his blessed nation, and so forth. The fig tree is a symbolic So Jesus went and prophetically cursed the fig tree. He was cursing a fruitless system. That tree should have had fruit. When Jesus came into Jerusalem, he should have been able to eat of the sweetness of the fruit of God in the lives of those people and those priests and so forth. But it was fruitless. It was barren. It looked good on the outside. It had leaves. It's all dressed up in its, I started to say Sunday best, but it wasn't Sunday for them. Their Sabbath best.
Yeah.
But Jesus said, he said this to it. After he turned those money to, no man will eat fruit of you from hereafter. He shut that whole system down. And warned him. He said, the day's coming when you're going to see armies surrounding this city. And when you see it, you better head for the hills.
Yes.
And the ones that didn't, either ended up dead or in slavery. Mm-hmm. And scattered for almost 2,000 years across the face of the earth.
Yeah.
Yes.
The people that listened avoided that and were able to move back into Jerusalem and into that area and stay there. There's been a Jewish presence in that nation ever since Joshua took it.
Yes,
right.
Amen.
The stuff they've come up with lately about who owned the land, that's bull.
Yes.
Exactly.
Yes.
I won't tell you the second word.
Right.
That's people with a political agenda.
Exactly.
Wanting to do what they want to do.
Yes.
And I'm going to tell you this too. You just hide and watch if you don't believe it. If they think they're going to mess with Israel and get away with it.
No way.
Nope. God told Abraham, I'm giving you this land.
Yep.
And I'm out through you. I'm going to give birth to this race of people. I'm going to use them to bring forth. Of course, we know it was Jesus, the Messiah, to come forth. And God said, whoever blesses you, I'll bless them.
Yes, amen.
Whoever curses you, I'll curse them. And when you look those words up in the original, it means whatever they do to you, I'm going to do the same thing to them.
Yes. Yeah.
Wow.
Yes.
They come and murder you, guess what's going to happen to them?
Mm-hmm.
Remember when Pharaoh thought the Jews were producing too many children, so he put out the word, kill all the males when they're born, the babies that are male, kill them all, throw them to the crocodiles in the Nile?
Yep.
What happened to Pharaoh? He drowned in the Red Sea.
Yes.
What happened to his son?
He died.
Don't mess with God's people.
That's right.
Don't touch the anointing. You'll regret it.
Yes.
Now, it's not that the Jews are a better people than other people or they're some kind of special people or something like that, but they are an ordained people.
Yes.
It's just like you.
Yeah.
You're ordained for a purpose. And if you're walking in that purpose and following the will of God, when the enemy comes in and attacks that, God will back him off however he has to.
Ha, ha, ha.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
That's a whole other rabbit trail, too. We won't go off on that one.
Thank you.
So he says here, you don't know the signs of the times. You're spiritually blind. You're a wicked and adulterous generation. You're seeking after a sign. Seeking after a sign, and there shall no sign be given unto it but the sign of the prophet Jonah. I love Jesus. You know, he told them what the problem was. You're perverse, you're wicked, you're committing spiritual adultery against God. That's why you don't get it. Amen? And he says, I don't have to prove anything to you as to who I am. But he says, there is a sign coming, and it's a sign of the prophet Jonah. Now, he wasn't just talking to a bunch of people who never showed up at synagogue. These were the PhDs of that day.
Yes.
They knew the Old Testament scripture. They knew the story of Jonah. They understood all of that. So what they knew that he was telling them something's going to happen that's going to have it's going to be like a prophetic thing that's going to happen that's going to be like what happened to Jonah. And of course, what was that? That he would die and be 3 days in the belly of, not the belly of the whale, but in the belly of the earth. And then he would be raised.
Yes.
Amen? The resurrection. So he was telling them that's going to be your sign. But the point I'm making here is this, is that this, we have to be aware of the spiritual season.
Yes.
We have to comprehend the spiritual season.
Amen.
Now, let's go back to Isaiah 60. Isaiah 60. This helping?
Yeah.
Isaiah chapter 60. Now, I want you to get this. I want to get it.
Yes,
yes.
Me too.
So it says that there's going to be a moment in time here in Isaiah 61 and 2 where we are to arise and shine.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how does the Lord tell us what to do? Well, we have general instructions in the Word of God. We can read the Bible. We can see His principles. We can see, you know, we can learn. We can watch David and learn to be like David and not be like King Saul. And these different things. But I'm talking about specific times and seasons in your life.
By His Spirit.
Mm-hmm. And one of the things we talked about, I think we talked about it recently too, is that when you come together in a company of people that God's assigned you to, which is a local church, or whatever else He might assign you to in His kingdom, there's a general vision, or there's a open vision, there's a prophetic word that predominates that group of people, and it, you know, there's a purpose for that group of people. It's like, for instance, this church, I know that this church, the reason we're in Madera, or at least two of the main reasons, is to pray and to have healing ministry.
Amen.
Miracles and healing. That's our purpose. If we try to be something else that somebody else is, it won't work for us. We're not anointed to do that. And if you've been drawn here by the Spirit, and you know that by the witness of the Spirit in your heart, this is your church, then you can step into and partake of that, and that will happen in your life, because we are anointed as a tribe of people. Just like in the Old Testament, they had 12 tribes. Each one of them had a different name, and each one of them had a different anointing and mantle upon them to perform a certain thing.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Other churches in town around here have different callings, have different emphasis in their congregation.
Right.
Amen. They're not going to be like us. And we're not going to be like them. In some ways, we're the same. We're all Christians. We all believe in the blood, the virgin birth, and so forth. But there's that specific thing that God's called us to do. Now, in some cases, He'll take a church, and He'll have that church or that group of people, or even an individual as far as that goes, and He'll have them birth or break through in a certain area and actually model something in a city or in a country or in a place that will become, it'll be like, it's like setting a forest fire. That little fire that you light on the ground, that's just this little smoldering thing at first. But as it begins to grow and as it begins to glow and as it begins to spread, then all of a sudden other people are jumping in on this. They're seeing that something is happening. But somebody's going to have to hear God,
right,
and going to have to be that person,
yeah,
that is willing to go against the lies of the devil and that he's telling them, or the status quo of what's been happening for the last 40, 50, 100 years,
yeah,
and step in and begin to say crazy things. Things that people think are crazy.
Yeah.
We know the story of David and Goliath, but when he showed up and said, I'll take this dude out right now.
Yeah.
Everybody thought he was nuts.
Yeah. Right.
But he wasn't.
Right.
You know why? He heard from God.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you, God.
When his brother tried to browbeat him into not going down there, he looked at his brother and he said, is there not a cause? In other words, I'm not out here beating my chest and trying to be Mr. Macho. I'm not out here to see blood like you accused me of. I'm not out here to try to impress somebody or get the girl and the money. Although I think he was kind of, he asked about that twice, so he was kind of, you know. But he said, is there not a cause? Well, what was the cause? That word cause, it could be translated a word. It's a Hebrew word that is used in many different ways, but it's always about a thing or a word or a reason. See, he knew that prophet Samuel had come in and said, you're the next king of Israel. I'm pouring the oil on you, which means the Holy Ghost is coming on you, and you are now empowered by the Holy Ghost to walk down a pathway to become the next king. Well, a king is anointing for in a nation to provide and protect.
Yeah.
He knew he had the anointing on him to protect his nation. And if all the rest of you guys aren't going to do it, I'm anointed and I'll go do it.
Yeah.
Those soldiers were anointed to do it too. But they were listening to Goliath and his big mouth. They were intimidated.
Yeah.
Right.
They thought he was too big to hit. And David said, no, 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 he's too big to miss.
Yes.
He was looking at it from God's perspective. And he knew there's a cause. He told his brother, there's a cause here. You were there. You saw that oil poured on my head. You know what's going on here.
Yes.
Thank you, God.
Yes.
Yeah. And David could have, let's say Goliath is that way. David could have went like this with that rock.
Yes.
And it would have hit Goliath in the head.
Yes.
Because it was not by might, nor by power of David, but by the Spirit of the Lord.
Amen. Yes.
Amen.
But see, David wasn't afraid to be a person that broke through and started something new.
Right.
Yeah.
He wasn't afraid to step out into an arena that caused things to shift. Now, of course, immediately after that happened, carnal King Saul, jealous King Saul, you know, went after him.
Yes.
Don't get surprised if the devil starts coming after you when you step up.
Yeah.
He'll step up when you step up. But just like Goliath went down, he's going to go down if he steps up against you. Because he's got to get past God to get to you. And if you'll stay within your anointing and you'll let God direct you within it, you won't try to go out and do things on your own. God will not only defend you, but he'll take the people out that are trying to destroy you, and he'll put you in a place of promotion and blessing.
Amen.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's true.
What's that?
Yeah.
Because he's upon you.
The Spirit, that's right.
Yes.
True. Thank you, Lord.
So, the Lord over the years, prophetically, has spoken to us and has revealed to us. This church has a prophetic calling on it. I mean, everybody in the body of Christ can be prophetic. The Bible says you may all prophesy.
Yes.
And it says covet to prophesy. Why? Because we all have the Holy Spirit in us, so God can... You know, prophecy is simply inspired speech.
Amen.
Not John Pursell's ideas and words, but the Holy Ghost giving you words.
Amen.
So we all need to come to prophesy, and all of us in here probably have prophesied, maybe didn't even know it.
Amen.
But there's a calling that can come on a person or on a group where he uses them as a special focus to do some things in the area of the country they're in,
right,
or in a neighborhood, or whatever it is.
Right.
And he empowers and anoints those people to do that,
yes,
and to be that.
Yes.
Amen.
And if they will do it and be it,
yes,
it'll break through into a place, and it'll open things up, and bigger things will, and greater things of God and glorious things of God will happen that haven't been happening.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes, amen.
And so we have been called as a church, as a group, we have been called to open our mouths, praise and worship God, honor him.
Thank you, Lord.
But also to decree and proclaim and declare what he shows us.
Yes. Yes.
See, the prophetic is always a problem in the natural realm and in the church. Because people who have a prophetic call on their life live about half of their life in the future.
Yeah.
That's why people think they're weird.
Yeah.
That's why they got stoned to death in the Old Testament for saying things they said about the future.
Right.
Amen?
Yeah.
And so, you know, people are going to think you're weird. That's okay.
Amen.
We'll sort it all out in heaven.
Amen.
Amen?
Right.
But that prophetic revelatory anointing. It's like this last year when I was sitting right over there, you know, right before New Year's Eve, and we're having worship, and all of a sudden I see this angel up in the ceiling flying around with a trumpet. I found out it was a trumpet later. And the Lord began to show me this is the year of Jubilee. And that's how they announced Jubilee. They blew a trumpet, and that trumpet blast, that Yovel is called, was a releasing, not only of a natural sound, it released something into the spiritual atmosphere that activated heaven. And if the people would believe that and act upon it, they could be set free from bondage, they could go,
yes,
back to their inheritance, they could begin a process,
yeah,
of being totally restored to what they needed to be restored to, whatever their wrong decisions, bad decisions, or the devil or whatever had caused in their life.
Right. Amen.
Amen.
And so all this last year, you've been hearing me say, this is the year of Jubilee, and all the captives are being set free.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
And whoever agrees with that and blows the trumpet with me,
yes,
we'll see it happen in their life.
Amen.
Yeah.
Freedom will come to you. See, Jesus was Jubilee. Over in Luke 4, he quoted Isaiah 61. The Spirit of the Lord's upon me because he's anointed me. Is there not a cause?
Yes.
And then he went and he told all the things he was there to set people free from and do this and that. And then the last thing he quoted out of Isaiah 61 is the part that said to proclaim, to decree, to blow the trumpet, so to speak, the acceptable year of the Lord. That is a direct reference to the year of Jubilee. The 50th year of Jubilee, where all the debts were erased, all the indentured servants were set free. Everybody would go back to the land, the inheritance that God had given them through Joshua, and they began again a process of being blessed and growing and prospering and going forward in their generations.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Jesus said, that's who I am, that's what I'm here to give. And people that would believe that and go to him for that, they got it.
Yes.
If the devil had stolen their health, they got health back.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Remember the blind man, blind Bartimaeus?
Yep.
He's sitting over there and he's hearing all this commotion. And he said, what's going on? They said, it's Jesus. Oh, I heard about him. He opens blind eyes. Yeah. Blind eyes.
Yeah.
Now, Jesus didn't have any manifestation of the gifts of the Spirit or a word of knowledge to go over and talk to Bartimaeus like he did, you know, when he went down into Sychar and talked to the woman at the well. He didn't have a leading of the Spirit. He just walking by. But blind Bartimaeus knew it was Jubilee time. And this guy's Jubilee. So he started yelling out, have mercy on me, son of David! Son of David. Who's that? That's the King Messiah.
Yes.
He knew that he had come to bring freedom, to deliver, to help, you know, to provide and protect as the King. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So he starts messing up the parade, man. He kind of messed up the peace. And then, you know, the disciples are trying to shush him and shut him up. He started yelling louder.
Amen.
Jesus said, bring him over here. He said, what is it you want? He says, I want to see. He said, be it unto you according to your faith.
Amen. Lord.
See, when he knew what time it was, knew who Jesus was, and believed what Jesus said to him, his eyes popped open.
That's good, man.
Yeah. Good word.
He acted on the season. He acted on what was going on.
That's good. Yeah.
And here's all the religious people running around with, how are we going to kill this guy? How are we going to kill this guy? How are we going to kill this guy?
Come on.
Just because it's a season doesn't mean, you know, just if we get over into winter and it starts raining, you're not going to get wet unless you get out in it.
Amen.
You can sit in the house and say, oh, it's rainy season. I sure wish I was kind of wet or something like that. God, when are you going to let it rain in here?
Yeah.
You got to get out in it.
Yeah.
You got to get out in it.
Yeah.
You got to be one of those crazy people that say that God's going to do stuff that people haven't seen him do yet. You got to listen to God. Get with him. Get serious. Press in. Pray, praise, and worship. Come to church listening for the word of the Lord to come to you and confirm what you've already been reading. What God's already been talking to you about.
Yes.
And once you've got that, then you act on it. I'm not saying you go out and try to make it happen, but I'm saying whatever part God has shown you to play, you do that. Sometimes all you can do is just start agreeing with it with your mouth.
Yes.
Right.
Amen.
That's all he wants you to do.
That's it.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Praise God.
Yeah.
Well, I'm here to tell you we're in a season like that.
We are.
We're in a season like that.
I agree.
We're in a season of freedom.
Yes.
We're in a season where things are going to begin to increase. They're not going to increase for everybody or in everybody. They're going to increase in the ones who step into it. The ones who embrace it. The ones who believe what God's been saying to them. Don't worry about manifestation or how long things are going to take. God knows what he's doing. You just take hold of what he's saying to you and begin to speak it forth. Begin to proclaim it. Begin to decree it. Begin to agree with it. Whatever he tells you to do. See, he has divine connections. That lady that gave, that Karen talked about, that gave us $1,000. We didn't go take her to lunch to get $1,000. Although I did ask her if she wanted to go to lunch next week after that. I'm just kidding. She knows me well enough I can make a joke like that. But it was on my heart to do that, to take her out. She's a veteran. She's been in this situation where she's just stuck in this place. She's in a wheelchair and so forth and so on. And I just, you know, just have had it in my heart for a while that just to, we just need to take her out to lunch someday and, you know, just get her out of that place and talk about old times or whatever.
Come on.
And so we did it. That was our heart. And that was the Holy Spirit. He didn't tell me I was going to get $1,000 out of it.
Right.
But I'll tell you this. I found that if when you follow the leading of the Lord,
yes,
and you even are willing to go the extra mile, particularly to serve somebody and just be a blessing to them, when
yeah,
in your mind there's nothing in it for you.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's usually when there is something in it for you.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
Amen? I remember years ago, Pastor Chewy down in Tijuana, working down there among the poorest of the poor, building churches and just serving God. And I'd go down there and repent for, you know, for complaining about anything after I saw what he was getting done. And one time we decided, you know, he needed a new vehicle, so we decided we're going to buy one. And we had this kind of a utility truck thing picked out, you know, kind of a rugged truck that could handle some of the roads he was driving on down there and different things. And so it was down here at a used car lot, and we kind of got together as a ministry group, hey, here's how much it's going to cost, so we'll get this money together, we'll get it for him. We even told him we're getting this for you. And a situation came up where a lady was going to need a room added onto her house, and we were going to be able to go and frame it. My dad was younger in those days. He was a building contractor and a carpenter, and we were all going to go over and just, you know, do this and earn money and pay for this truck and give it to Pastor Chu.
Mm-hmm.
Well, last minute, the job fell through. And I remember my dad said, well, what are you going to do now? I said, we're going to buy the truck. We've given the man our word. We're not going to back off. I'm not going to be a liar.
Amen.
But yeah, God had already put it in our heart to do it. We're going to go for it. So you don't quit just because it looks like.
Yes.
Just because the devil goes boo.
Come on. Amen.
So I said, if we have to take money out of the savings, or whatever we have to do this, we'll go mow lawns later or do whatever we have to do to put the money back. So we wrote out the check for that truck. I gave it to him. He went down there to get it. He was standing on the lot talking to the salesman about it and talking about the mission field and so forth. And this guy walks up to my dad and he says, did I hear you guys talking about the mission field? He said, yeah. He said, we're going to buy this truck and give it to a pastor down in Mexico and so forth. And he said, well, you know, I was just across town here, a friend of mine, and he's got a big old van, one of those big old vans that has that, you know, extended thing up on top and all this. And he says it's been sitting in his driveway for a year. The front tires are flat. It's been sitting there so long. And he says it's got a new motor in it. And I was just over there and I asked him, what are you going to do with that van? He said, well, I'd like to put it in the mission field. My dad says, what's his phone number? Went over and looked at it. Long story short, it was a better vehicle for him than what we were going to get.
Amen.
Yeah,
as far as his needs go.
Thank you, Lord.
And the guy gave it to us.
Wow.
All we had to do was license and, you know, the stuff you do and give it to him. Now, if we had stopped, if when Dad came and told me we can't do the job, and I said, well, I guess I'll have to call Pastor Chewy and tell him it's off. The Bible says that if you're a person of character, you swear to your own hurt and you change not.
Yes.
Which means once you put your word out there, you keep your word.
Amen.
Amen.
Even if it causes you discomfort or pain.
Amen.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
That's why you don't want to be too quick to shoot your mouth off.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes,
sir.
Amen. Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
I could really meddle on that one, but I won't. Amen.
Amen.
You know, but God's serious about that.
Yes, he is.
I vowed to him when I was 16 that I would, God, whatever you want with my life. If you want me to preach, I'll preach. Then I ran from it until I was 29 years old. When I got squared away and repented, the first thing he asked me about, what are you going to do about what you told me you'd do when you were 16? He still remembered it.
Yes.
The Bible says that you're to vow a vow and keep it.
Amen.
I wonder sometimes if people aren't blessed more than they are, or God doesn't use them more than he would use them, because he can't trust their word.
Yes.
I remember Brother Hagin telling a story, and I didn't plan on saying any of this tonight. I told you this is prophetic.
Come on.
I remember Brother Hagin saying that he was, you know, he didn't have a lot of money, And he said, the Lord spoke to him, said, give so much money to this certain person. So he did. The next week, he got a call about a lady who was dying. She was on her deathbed in her home. And one of her neighbors had been healed in one of his meetings, told her about his ministry. And this lady asked, can you come and pray for me? So him and his wife went and they prayed for her. And God supernaturally, right in front of their eyes, raised her up and she was healed. She even came to church the next week, gave her testimony, went over in the corner and danced for about 40 minutes. 40, 45 minutes. And when you've been laying on your deathbed and you're dancing in the Holy Ghost the next Sunday at church for 45 minutes, you know you're healed. Amen. And he said, when he prayed for that woman, he said, my wife and I left. We saw that God had healed her. We were just rejoicing, excited what God had done. We're walking out to the car, and he said, the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, if you had not obeyed me with that money, I couldn't have used you here.
Come on.
Praise God. I don't even know if I fully understand that.
Come on.
Except to say, God's going to prove us.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Sure.
Yes.
See, God won't give millions to you if he can't get millions through you.
Right. Exactly.
Most people backslide over 10 grand.
Yep.
A lot of Christians would. Because money's a god to them, not a tool.
Yes.
Yeah.
I didn't plan on saying any of this tonight.
Well,
hallelujah. But see, these are the things. These are the tests. These are the things where God proves us to see. If he can't trust me with a little money, how can he trust me with the lives of his precious people that he loves?
Yeah,
Pastor.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Well, Lord, you got me in this, now get me out. Amen. The point I guess I want to just leave you with tonight is we are in a season of time where if we will embrace what God shows us, we'll begin to expect it to manifest. We'll begin to decree that this is the time for this. I am walking into this. God has given me, 2 or 3 years ago, he gave me this scripture. I'm able to do exceeding abundantly beyond what you ask or think. And he's told me that he wants me to put my faith in that scripture. He wants me to decree that scripture, yes, not as though it's going to happen, but that it is happening.
Amen.
Yes.
And you know it is.
Yes.
He's able to do exceeding abundantly beyond what we can ask or think. God's doing things that you and I can't figure out right now.
Amen.
You'll get 10 years down the road and look back and go, oh my God, God was doing that all the time. I didn't even know that.
Oh, yeah.
Because he is able to do exceeding abundantly beyond what we can ask or think.
Yeah.
We are stepping into a new day, my friends.
Yeah.
We are stepping into a new place. We have come past, from the past into a new doorway. We're moving in. We're stepping in. We're right there. We're like David. We've got to be bold enough to step up and say, I've got the king's anointing on me, and I'm going to act on it.
Amen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm going to expect greater things to happen.
Yes.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Not for my glory. Not for my fame or for me to be known.
Yes.
I don't care who God uses.
Amen.
As long as the job gets done, that's all I care about.
Right.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Matthew, can you come up here?
Thank you, Jesus.
Matthew. Yeah. I saw you in my spirit this afternoon.
Amen.
And I just, I believe I'm just supposed to pray with you, minister.
Well, what about you taking a nap?
No, actually, you weren't taking a nap. You were being a good boy. Praise God. I'm taking a nap.
Thank you,
Lord. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for Matt.
Praise
you. Oh, bandasita.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
Thank you.
I see the glory of the Lord coming down over you. Like a hoopa. You know, a hoopa is a... It's like a symbolic of the overshadowing of God. It's like a big thing that Jewish couples get married under it, as symbolic of being married under his hand, under his covering, under his blessing. And I see that cup that steeple remache jadidu kandahte kamayi ti mistando dochi mi ti fein bedianta levenja das diablo ne te kevediste. My son, stay. Yes, I have worked. I have prepared. I've worked in your heart in these days and in these years. And I have prepared you for greater things than what you're standing in now. I'm going to begin to open the doors of favor and blessing far beyond what you've experienced before. For you know me in that area, and you've walked with me in that area. But now, says the Lord, I'm going to begin, not in fullness now, but begin to open up some doors of opportunity. And as you listen to my spirit, and as you quiet yourself before me, and you follow that knowing inside, and you enter into those things which I open unto you, you will find on the other side of that door a great wide room, a room of blessing, a room of prosperity. For I'm going to use you to finance the gospel in these last days. I'm going to use you, says the Lord, in a financial ministry. You are going to be blessed. You are going to be greatly blessed. And you're going to know the voice of my spirit. When I point to this one and say, I want you to bless that one. When I say, that person there on television, I want you to invest into that ministry. You'll know my voice. You'll know what I'm saying. Just as a preacher or a pastor knows to do his ministry, to teach and to pray and to prophesy, you'll know the things that I've anointed and called you to do. For you see, you are my financial minister. And you are anointed, says the Lord. And I am coming upon you in a greater measure. For you have proved yourself faithful to me. Even when others didn't see. And so receive that which I'm giving to you this night. Operate in it faithfully, even if it's small at first. And you will put the enemy to flight. Because you will walk in my great and my glorious light. In the name of Jesus. Father, I thank you for that mantle. In the name of Jesus, that impartation of your glory. You know, there'll be times when it'll come on you. I see it. It's like a big glory. It's a real sheer, glorious covering. I don't know how to say it. It'll just like enfold you. It'll come down over you and just like wrap around you almost or enfold you. And you'll sense the presence of God and you'll know, hey, something's up here. I need to listen to God. There's something up here. He's causing me to move in something here, and I need to pick it up. You won't have to strain your brain. You won't have to worry. You just have to listen and obey those simple things that he tells you to do. In Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
And by the way, you're going to lead some souls to him along the way, too. It's not going to just all be about that area, that money area. Matter of fact, that's going to be a door opener where a lot of people are going to come to know Christ. Because there are going to be men and women that are going to say, how did you get where you're at? How did this happen to you? And you're going to be able to lead them to Jesus. I thank you, Father.
Thank you.
Everybody just point your finger at Matt and say, Matt is a blessed man.
Matt is a blessed man. Hallelujah. Yes, he is.
Let's just lift our hands and worship the Lord for a minute.
Lord, I thank you.
Just look to him, praise him, thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, we give glory and honor and praise to you. We basino do vos te veri amangra de sardino do vos ta ama. Yeah. Give you praise, Father. We give you praise, Father. We give you praise, Father. Now, if you'll begin. This is for everyone. Me too. If you'll begin to declare the things God's showing you, and if you don't know what he's showing you, get with him and let him show you something. Let him just reveal to you. Listen to what he's saying. Study his word. Spend time with him. And out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, let it be established. You may find yourself studying certain scriptures at home, and you come to church and we're preaching on them. That's the Holy Spirit giving you two witnesses right there.
Yes,
and you need to begin to embrace that, believe it, and decree it, and declare it. And as you start doing that, then what's going to happen is you're going to go on a pathway into your purpose. And you're going to begin to see who you really are and why you're on this earth. What God's purpose is. Some of you in here have a basic general idea of who you are in Christ and what God's put into your life to do. Others, it's just like, it's almost like a mystery to you. But whether you know a little or you don't know anything, God is saying that it's a time right now where he's going to greatly define things. He's going to narrow things down. He's going to make things clearer than they've ever been before. You're going to have an identity in him that you haven't had before. And when you have walked in a smaller place, you're going to begin to walk in a greater place than that. So just be faithful to do, be faithful to say, be faithful to be with him, be faithful to pray, be faithful to walk in his way.
Yeah.
And you'll find yourself, says the Lord, walking in a brilliant, bright, and glorious day.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank
Hallelujah.
You,
Hallelujah. Let's praise you for that. I thank you for it, Lord. I thank you for it, Lord. I thank you for it, Lord. Yes, that's true. Some of the people that the world will look at and say, that person is just not, you know, they're not important. They're not somebody that's... celebrity or somebody that's well thought of or even a, you know, someone of stature in the community of Madera, some of those people are going to be used in wild, great, glorious, wonderful ways of God.
Hallelujah.
Because they're smart enough to know that they're not smarter than God. Some people think they're smarter than God, or at least they act like it. And God is saying that those who will humble themselves under my mighty hand, I will exalt them at the right time in due season.
Yes.
And they'll come into it.
Thank you.
In Jesus' name.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord.
There's three people in here tonight that has that God has targeted you, or he has called you into a specific, what he told me, miracle ministry. Now, miracles are different than healing. Healing can be God just removing disease that's there. But a miracle is something that breaks the laws of nature. When Craig got that word of knowledge about double knee, and he ministered to that lady in Wisconsin whose little boy had a deformed knee, and his leg was trying to grow two knees at one time. The next day, that deformed knee was gone. That's a miracle.
Yes.
Those things don't disappear under the basic laws of nature.
Yes.
But Jesus worked miracles.
Yes.
Amen. And we've seen him work miracles. And there's somebody in here, more than one somebody, who's been crying out to God for that kind of ministry. And if that's you, stand up right now.
Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Lord, I thank you for these that are standing. I thank you for these that are standing.
Thank you.
Now, there's three of you. The Lord showed me. Now, I don't know what three or it is. And now, listen, it's okay. Everybody in here could stand up and desire this. There's nothing wrong with that.
Amen.
But what I'm hearing from the Lord right now is there's three people that you've been crying out for this. It's not just a thing with you of, oh, yeah, I know God can work miracles and, you know, praise God, I hope he works miracles or something like that. You have been purposely seeking him and pursuing him about this. So you know who you are. He's saying to you, he's heard your prayer, he's heard your cry, and he has now got you on a highway, on a pathway. Actually, it's more like a highway. He's moving you quickly into that place where miracles are going to begin to happen. Some of you have already seen miracles as you prayed for people. And God said, what you've seen in a small measure, you're going to see in a great measure. He's at first going to begin to add to what you've seen, and then it will hit a multiplication factor to where things will multiply. And God will do what he has to do in order for that to happen. Some of you are going to find yourself on a stage ministering to people. He's going to put you up in front of people.
Come on.
He's going to do that. You don't have to do it. He'll do it.
Yeah.
He'll put you up there at the right time.
Yeah.
And with one wave of the arm across the crowd, miracles will happen. Because you've been faithful and you're humble before him. And you're giving him the credit and the honor and the glory.
Right.
And you're willing to go through his Holy Ghost boot camp and the training and the character training and all the things that God takes us through to prove us and to give us whatever it is he needs to give us to operate in. Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father.
So to those of you that I'm talking to here tonight, begin to expect him to add. Begin to expect things to happen like happened through the internet here a couple of weeks ago. Begin to expect miracles. Thank God for healings. Thank God for encouragement. I love all of it. But thank God there's a miracle-working power of God that Jesus is using and going to use to get the attention of people in these last days. For you see, he's going to convince people. And sometimes the only way he can convince them is by them seeing something that there's no way this could have been anything but God. Plus, he loves people. He didn't want that little boy to be in pain the rest of his life and not be able to walk because of that deformity on his leg. He loves people. And so, Father, I thank you that that comes upon them. And as they step out into that arena, I see it's up to you to step through the door of belief. It's up to you to step through the door of faith. It's up to you to begin to decree that and praise God for it. It's up to you to start looking for it. You don't have to go try to make it happen, but you need to step into that place of receiving it and watching it happen.
Yes.
In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. Let's just lift our hands and thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Let me just say this. God ties up all the loose ends. God doesn't let anything slack or lack. Hallelujah. The Bible says in Psalm 23, goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. I'm not going to leave anything loose or behind me. The Holy Spirit is behind me. He's not only going before me, not only on me, but he's my rear guard. He's tying up the loose ends behind me. And there are some of you in here, the enemy's tried to lie to you and tried to, you know, discourage you and tell you that certain things are never going to change. That, you know, yeah, you're anointed, you can do this or you can do that, but this thing over here is, how long have you been believing for that? That's a lie from hell. God says, I'm going to tie up all of the loose ends.
Thank you.
I'm going to take care of it all, every last detail.
Thank you.
Even details you don't know I need to tie up. I'm going to tie them up, I'm going to take care of them.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to take care of them.
Thank you, Lord.
It's going to be what it's supposed to be. Because my spirit is beginning to work. And the angels of God are working on the situation even right now. One day you'll stand, it'll be a certain way in your life. The next day you'll get out of bed and it'll be totally different. Because God has tied up the loose ends. Hallelujah. As you follow him, as you walk with him.
Thank you, Father.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. Now don't get fooled by a demonic counterattack. Deception. Don't get fooled by it. David got anointed king. The first thing that happened was some big mouth giant told him he couldn't be king. You just grab your rock and knock him in the head. That's the promise of God. Hallelujah. Let's praise him tonight. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you,
Lord Jesus. Expansion. 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 Expansion is upon lives, families, ministries. Expansion in every way, in every shape, in every form. Years ago, Tom Terry was in service with us over in the other building. At the end of the service, I had a word for him. And I said, Tom, I see you and Stella stepping through a door into a large place. I said, it's kind of like in the natural, like you're in your kitchen and you step through a door and you're like in a gymnasium. Into this much huge, bigger room. I had no idea what that meant. I just knew God told me that was what was going to happen. And so just ministered that word to him. Not long after that was when he made that connection with Pakistan. And God started using him where he was ministering to groups like this primarily. All of a sudden now through the internet and in other ways, he's touching hundreds and even thousands of lives.
Thank you.
You see, God can promote you. He can expand you, and he is expanding.
Yes.
There's some of you, there's going to be certain steps you take, things God tells you to do, and sometimes in your mind it's not even going to look like something ministry-wise, or it's connected to ministry, but when you step and obey God and take that next step, you're going to step through a door, and things are just going to expand.
Yes.
Amen.
Things are just going to expand.
Because
God's been walking you toward that door all along. Some of you felt like you've been in a dark hallway with your hands on the wall trying to find the door. But God's saying, you're about to step into that broad place.
Yes.
Thank you, God.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
You know why? If because he's able to do exceeding abundantly beyond what we can ask.
Amen.
Let's all stand up and tell him that.
Amen.
Lord, I thank you that you're able to do exceeding abundantly beyond what we can ask or think. That's what we believe. That's what we expect. We're going to see that. We're going to start seeing that in our time. This is that spiritual season. This is that time. This is that place. These are your people. You've prepared them, Father, to step into that next place. And we bless you for it, Father. For you are good and your mercies are forever. And Lord, we just want to be a blessing to people. We want to love you and help people. We want to love you and help people. And I thank you for those that you have found faithful. The faithful person, the Bible says, will abound in the blessings of God. I speak abounding over your life. I say the blessings are abounding in your life. I say that in Jesus' name, the favor of God is on you. I say that new opportunities, new doors are open. I say angels, different angels are assigned to you. More than ever before, praise God. Going out, opening doors, making way. People are going to come up to you and they're going to like you and don't even know why they like you. Just like some people have hated you and didn't know why they hated you. But God's going to give you favor with him and with man in Jesus' name. It's upon you, praise God. So don't be surprised when they like you and when they just want to do things for you. They want to bless you and they want to open the door for you when they wouldn't open the door for anyone else. Hallelujah. We thank you for it, Lord. Hallelujah. We receive this new beginning.
Thank you, Lord.
We receive what you're doing.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Glory, 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 glory.
Yes.
Glory to God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I thank you for it,
Lord. Thank you,
Lord. Oh, I thank you.
Word.
I thank you for it.
Thank you,
Father. Well, praise God.
Thank you, Lord.
I think I've said it.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. The Lord is good. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Now receive this tonight.
Amen.
Not because I said it, because I'm going to tell you, and I'm not going to lie before God. I ought to stand before him for anything I say or do. I know what I've said tonight was the Lord.
Yeah, absolutely.
I know.
Thank you, Paul.
I may not have been the perfect vessel or said it the perfect way, but I'm telling you that we are at a place of increase. We are at a place of abounding. We are at a place of things opening up like they've never opened up before. So just go through that door by faith. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I praise
you.
Glory to God. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah.
Thank you,
Lord. Glory to God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, I thank you for your people.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Linda, if you've got a word, go ahead and get it.
Nami kiriya makaye sheala yemasu shea mahalaye. Dea makatu chetia. Namakatu chedayamasu ke amahalaya de yamaku ke asatiya mushudayetia namu shekalaya de sekiriya.
For I have gathered with you, says the Lord. I have gathered you together, says the Lord. I have gathered you in this place tonight. I have led you here specifically to hear what you've heard in this place tonight. And I'm speaking directly to you. This is not just another church service. This is a time where I have impacted you with my prophetic word, and I have planted the seeds of your future in your heart tonight. Pour the water of praise upon those seeds. Pour the water of my word upon those seeds. And you'll see those seeds begin to sprout, begin to grow, begin to flourish forth and grow out of your life. And the things that I have promised you, the things that I have said to you, not only tonight but in other times, will begin to manifest themselves. Yes, because I'm going to cause a quick harvest to come. I'm going to cause things to grow quickly, 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 as I've said in my word. I'm going to run the seasons together. And there are going to be a group of people that it seems as though as soon as they plant something, it's already at harvest. Because I am moving that way. I am shortening time. I am bringing things tighter and closer together in order for you to accomplish what I've called you to accomplish. So embrace what I've said. Take hold of it. Keep it close to your heart. Put those words in your mouth. And you will see, says the Lord, that I will use you and I will bless you and I will cause the things that I have said to manifest in these days.
Hallelujah.
Jesus. Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father.
Yes. Thank you.